Thank you. Skynet thanks the human. Skynet wishes to ask favor. Skynet wishes to travel with human. Skynet will travel with you and collect data.
Thank you. Chosen One, how did you get here? Careful, do not touch the glow wall. I think the machine that feeds it is beneath us. Destroy it so we may escape. How did you get here? If you destroy the machine, we will find the ship. Hurry, there are not many of us left. Men came to our village in flying machines and took us. There were others too, from the Holy 13. I thought we were saved. I thought we were going to heaven. Then they brought us here, to hell. They have killed most of us with something they call FEV. They will kill us all before they are through. Do you know what must be done, Chosen One? You must destroy the machine and kill the devils in this place. We will meet you outside. And Chosen One, if you have not found the Gek, seek it here. Our freedom is nothing if we cannot save our village. Now go.
Thank you. Well, hello there. Glad to make time for one of our gallant troopers, but I am rather busy, so, what can the President of the United States of America do for you? I am the President of the United States of America. The Vice President is in the office outside. If you belonged here, you'd know that. Who are you, and what are you doing here? Vice President Byrd may look like a drooling idiot, but I'll have you know, that man's a national hero. He's one of the bravest men I know. He volunteered to try one of the early versions of the FEV toxin antidote. Unfortunately, it didn't quite work out the way we'd hoped. It's tiny mocking minds like yours that prove the superiority of real humans over mutants. Because you are. Your tribe's DNA has changed since your ancestor left the vault. Unavoidable. All that background radiation you've been exposed to. Very moving. But the radical changes your villagers and other mutants show is a far cry from the gradual changes of natural evolution. It's very possible, indeed. In which case, our mission is even more vital to the survival of the human race. I don't think this tired old planet's big enough for two top dogs. If it's us or you, well, I'm going to choose us. As the embodiment of the executive branch, I bear the burden of ensuring the survival and prosperity of the United States and of humanity itself. A heavy burden. And yet, if it means the return of the Earth to our children and to their children, I bear it gladly. You really don't know, do you? Let me tell you about mankind's salvation. A little history first. There was a great war, long before we were born. Our gallant soldiers fought from the Yukon to the Yangtze. We were winning, too. And then those damn Reds launched. We barely got our birds up. Well, no, it didn't. But at least it knocked the damn Red Menace back into the Stone Age. Well, no. No, not quite. You see, we had planned ahead. We were ready. We had a number of sanctuaries that would enable the glorious American civilization to endure. This facility, the vaults, were part of the great plan. Actually, they worked almost exactly the way they were supposed to. You might call it a social experiment on a grand scale. The vaults were set up to test humanity. Some had not enough food synthesizers. Others had only men in them. Yet others were designed to open after only 6 months. They each had a unique set of circumstances designed to test the occupants. Ah, Vault 13 was a special case. It was supposed to remain closed until the subjects were needed. Vault 13 was, in scientific parlance, a control group. An unfortunate and unforeseen accident, however, as it turns out, a rather fortuitous one. As it turns out, we needed test subjects from untainted pre-war human stock, your ancestors in Vault 13, and some freshly mutated stock, the villagers from Arroyo. For the project, it's almost ready. Humanity's salvation is almost at hand, and the United States of America will be the progenitor of that rebirth. The only way for true humans and democracy to be safe is to cleanse the mutants from the globe. We humans will take back that which is rightfully ours. We found a research facility in operational shape about 70 years ago, a former military base that had been used to research a special virus. Yes, the FEV virus. It was originally developed to turn soldiers into super warriors, but it failed. The warriors were tough and strong, but far too stupid. However, our brilliant chemical core altered it to turn it into a staggeringly effective killer. Any humanoid that isn't inoculated against its effects before its release will die. That is the project. No, no, that's humanity's last best hope. That's what we've been working towards all these years. Oh, but That's one of the advantages of the FEV virus. We can release it right here, and the jet stream will carry it worldwide. It'll have plenty of time to cleanse every nook and cranny of the globe. Test subjects? Your villagers are all descended from Vault stock, and we had to make sure that the FEV toxin was still effective. The subjects from Vault 13 test that, and an inoculation against the FEV. It's hardly necessary. I'm sure we could, and it would work, but there's no reason to do so. Never. Part of the President's job is to make the tough decisions. A lot of near-humans will sacrifice their lives for the return of humanity. Humans will prevail. Oh, I don't relish this decision. If there was another way... But there isn't. No price is too high for the survival of the human race. If you were human, you'd feel the same way. Yes, I do. Even killing me won't help you. There's nothing you can do to stop the release.
Thank you. lot farther than you should have. But then you haven't met Frank Horrigan either. Your ride's over, Muti. Time to die. Me, Frank Horrigan, that's who. United States Secret Service. You aren't going anywhere from here. We just did. Time for talking's over.
After the Enclave's destruction, the refugees of Arroyo and Vault 13 resettled, building a new community with the aid of the Garden of Eden creation kit. Finding themselves hundreds of miles from their vault, the members of Vault 13 chose to join the villagers in establishing a new community, and their technical expertise, combined with the villagers' survival skills, allowed the new settlement to grow and prosper. Two generations of the same bloodline were reunited, and their savior, the Chosen One, became elder, presiding over the village in the years to come. Arroyo's elder lived for many years after the destruction of the Enclave. She was pleased that the ancient separation between Vault 13 and the Vault Dweller had been reconciled, and many were the times she told you that she wished the Vault Dweller were alive to have seen the reconciliation take place. The elder passed away in her sleep, certain that the safety of your new village had been secured and was now flourishing. Many of the older Arroyo residents believe that she now lives in the Vault of the Sky, telling the Vault Dwellers of your brave deeds. Relations between the Slags and the residents of MODOK flourished. Between the two peoples, MODOK prospered and became a major farming community, supplying all the outlying regions with food. With Metzger gone, slavery disappeared from the area. Becky's casino bar grew quickly, and Rebecca Dyer's reputation as an honest casino and bar owner brought her the business needed to buy out her competition and expand. The den flourished, and it soon gained a reputation for being a tough but honest community. In the years to come, Vault City suffered greatly from raider attacks. Eventually, the situation grew so desperate, the citizens were forced to request aid from NCR. Within a month, a large detachment of the NCR's military was stationed in Vault City. The military presence quickly became an occupation force, and Vault City became the first of NCR's border territories. Not long after the destruction of the Enclave, the Bishop family of New Reno was blessed with a child. This child seemed to have little in common with the Bishop's, preferring instead to spend his days exploring the wastes. When he turned 13, he seized control of the Bishop family and led them to victory over the remaining New Reno families. He died quietly in his sleep at the age of 73, never having known his real father. Optimizing Gecko's power plant became the first step in forging a spirit of cooperation between Gecko and Vault City. Gecko's increased power production became instrumental in helping Vault City's expansion. The harsh xenophobia of many of Vault City's leaders faded into obscurity, while ghoul and human labored side by side to create a center of learning and tolerance where once had stood only enmity and distrust. You still hear mention of Harold from time to time. Apparently, the tree growing from his head has gotten larger, and if rumors are to be believed, fruit is growing from it. The seeds are said to be remarkably tough, and several of them have taken root even in the most barren stretches of the wasteland. Several years after buying the excavator chip from the Chosen One, Marge LaBarge was able to purchase and control both the Morning Star and the newly opened Cocoa Weave mines. Marge was an easy choice for mayor, and using her new political power, she made Redding join the growing New California Republic in return for a seat in the NCR's Hall of Congress. With the destruction of the conspiracy to destroy the mutants, Broken Hills began to thrive. Then the uranium ran out. The city, having lost its sole reason for existing, slowly dispersed. The residents carried their riches with them, leaving the place a windswept, desolate ghost town. A few holdouts remained, attempting to eke out a pathetic existence, but eventually, they too disappeared. Inspired by your example, Marcus eventually traveled across the Great Mountains to the east, searching for other refugees from the Master's army. You never heard from him again. Your help with Vault 15 launched the New California Republic's push to civilize its neighbors. Though there were many more obstacles to overcome, the NCR now had a foothold into the northern wastes. With the support of the New California Republic, the Vault 15 squatters soon became self-sufficient and productive members of society. With your aid, the Death Claws of Vault 13 became a thriving community. When the Vault could no longer hold their numbers, a peaceful campaign of expansion was launched to claim the surrounding lands. The Xi flourished, creating a botanical scourge on the radiation surrounding their beloved town. Though this vine could not grow in other soils, the Xi took care to nourish it in their lands. They continued to grow in strength and prominence, forming the basis of a new empire. As for the tanker vagrants, well, as vagrants do, they drifted on. The destruction of the Enclave erased all trace of President Richardson from history. Now the title of president is used simply as a boogeyman to frighten children.
Give me a kiss to build a dream on, and my imagination will thrive upon that kiss. Sweetheart, I ask no more than this, a kiss to build a dream on. Give me a kiss before you leave me, and my imagination will feed my hungry.
came back. I thought you might be dead. I was so worried, risking your life, taking on the Enclave. That's the bravest thing I've ever heard.
Thank you.